It just seemed to be a perfect fit. It completely aligns with what I'm trying to do here, you know, with the oceanography and marine biology program. They have a lagoon that the kids can swim in their free time, and you know, manatee will swim in, and you know, there's a nurse shark that hangs out on the bottom, and you know, there's a underwater hotel. They didn't miss their electronics. They didn't get homesick because there's always something that they can do and there's something that they can explore. It starts off with an investigation of the ocean itself and our interactions with the ocean. We look at kind of some of the simplest organisms, you know, your one-celled organisms, to marine plants, to, you know, multicellular organisms, all the way up to, you know, marine mammals. And we do all of this before we go, just so the kids are prepared. And then once they get there, they blow the staff away with what they know. When you start talking about the Earth's oceans, it's not just, you know, the physical water of it. It's the interaction that we have with it. You know, the seagrasses, and we hit the mangroves, and you know, we talk about the Everglades. And even if you're not interested in manatee, there, you know, hey, we're going to study, you know, reef ecology. There's the geology, there's, you know, the hydrology, there's the chemistry, there's so much, you know, climate, and there's, you know, we got to experience all kinds of weather patterns, and it's really science at its best. It's funny, every year we go, for the past 3 years, the instructors have always said, you know, oh my gosh, these kids from landlocked Indiana know more about the Earth's oceans and about, you know, the ecologies of Florida than the kids that actually visit from Florida, which just blows my mind. I think we challenge them. You know, the instructors there, a lot of times our kids will catch them off guard, and they will actually say, well, we're going to have to go and we're going to have to look into that for you. And they'll come back, you know, in the nighttime sessions on the floating classroom during one of our evening labs and say, well, you know, we found an answer for you. I can't tell you how many times that's happened to me in here. They'll ask me a question. I'm like, oh my gosh, I never considered that. You're living with people, you're rooming with people and sharing with people that you wouldn't normally do. And it's great for bringing them together. It's neat to see them interact as kids. I mean, they, you know, during their free time, if they're not kind of free snorkeling the lagoon, they're playing volleyball, or they're throwing bags in the courtyard, and you know, they're just doing kids stuff rather than being plugged in. They have a dive buddy, and their dive buddy, you know, might not be a strong swimmer, and to be in charge of someone else and to be responsible for keeping track of somebody else, just, you know, it becomes less about them and more about each other. You know, when I first came to Sycamore, they said, hey, you're going to be teaching oceanography. Why oceanography in Indiana? But it makes sense, because it is a way that we can talk about alternative energy, and it's a way that we can talk about, you know, affecting global change, and, you know, what it means to be a good global citizen. And they very much think about things like that. I did a little mini lesson on plastics and microplastics and the problem that is microplastics. And they were looking at the bigger picture, the long-term, you know, ramifications of making these choices. And, you know, well, other countries have eliminated single-use straws and plasticware. Well, why don't we? And they start asking those bigger questions, like, well, we should be doing more. They're brilliant kids, and they, you know, they challenge everyone, and they ask those questions, and they make those connections that I think a lot of kids don't make.
same or are they all different?
They're all different.
Right. So you did the painting, and then I added a word. But does everybody have the same word?
No.
You make a good choice.
You make good choices. So guess what? You all have your own word. Some might say honesty.
Good. you're pitching on 15. Harlan, you're down. You got 1-on-1. Look up.
Yeah. Thank you.
one-on-one, got it. Watch out.
So printmaking originally dates back to about 1400 for fabrics and for textile purposes. Artists got a hold of that process and started printing things of their artwork so that they could sell more copies of their artwork, that it was done on wood block so that it would be printed on silks, and so you could put a pattern on something and do it multiple times. So the story goes that Vincent van Gogh was exposed to Japanese printmaking when he opened up some of his art supplies, and there were just like rough copies of Japanese woodblock prints in there as packing material. Mm-hmm. Fell in love with those. And if you look at some of his work, he was very heavily inspired by those. And you can even see self-portraits where he has Japanese woodblocks prints hanging behind him that he puts in his own paintings. Printmaking is a very gratifying art process for the kids, and the idea of creating their own art that they can duplicate is very satisfying. We live very much in a culture and time where people like instant satisfaction, gratification. It's a bit of a surprise element, so they know what they think they're going to get, and they won't know exactly what's going to show up until they ink it and print it, and then they get to do the peel back, and when they hit the big reveal, you get a lot of oohs and ahs. Sometimes there's fun surprises, sometimes they're like, how do I make this work? So it's a lot of problem solving, which I love for them, because that's something that they need to stretch their brains into problem solving, so art's a good way to help them do that. I think a lot of art is, it's the process of art making that's part of the joy of creating art. And it's not to be lost. Sometimes the act of making it is something just worth repeating. And printmaking is really graphic and bold, and there's something beautiful about the handmade quality of printmaking. So when you see it, you know it was carved by hand, it was etched by hand, and then printed. And people connect with that. They connect with the handmade quality of it rather than it just be rapidly shot off of a printer or a copy machine. I grew to love it, and I wanted to share that love of printmaking with the kids because I think it's a really special art form. Mm-hmm. And I think, like most artists, if you love something, you want to share it with others.
I am excited. I went and talked to some of the people up there. I talked to a lot of the veterans. We have over 12 veterans here today. And I think they come from all that. We got some in the Air Force. I saw from the Navy and the Air Force, Navy, Army.
They all different.
They're all different.
Right. So you did the painting, and then I added a word. But does everybody have the same word?
No.
You make a good choice.
You make good choices. So guess what? You all have your own word. Some might say honesty.
Some might say curiosity.
Or maybe pipeline.
Put your rocks down.
Okay. Nice.
Wow.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah. Go Go.
Come back in, shot, shot corner. Good, good.
Rebound. Yeah. Go home!
So printmaking originally dates back to about 1400 for fabrics and for textile purposes. Artists got a hold of that process and started printing things of their artwork so that they could sell more copies of their artwork, that it was done on wood block so that it would be printed on silks, and so you could put a pattern on something and do it multiple times. So the story goes that Vincent van Gogh was exposed to Japanese printmaking when he opened up some of his art supplies, and there were just like rough copies of Japanese woodblock prints in there as packing material. Mm-hmm. Fell in love with those. And if you look at some of his work, he was very heavily inspired by those. And you can even see self-portraits where he has Japanese woodblocks prints hanging behind him that he puts in his own paintings. Printmaking is a very gratifying art process for the kids, and the idea of creating their own art that they can duplicate is very satisfying. We live very much in a culture and time where people like instant satisfaction, gratification. It's a bit of a surprise element, so they know what they think they're going to get, and they won't know exactly what's going to show up until they ink it and print it, and then they get to do the peel back, and when they hit the big reveal, you get a lot of oohs and ahs. Sometimes there's fun surprises, sometimes they're like, how do I make this work? So it's a lot of problem solving, which I love for them, because that's something that they need to stretch their brains into problem solving, so art's a good way to help them do that. I think a lot of art is, it's the process of art making that's part of the joy of creating art, and it's not to be lost. Sometimes the act of making it is something just worth repeating. And printmaking is really graphic and bold, and there's something beautiful about the handmade quality of printmaking. So when you see it, you know it was carved by hand, it was etched by hand, and then printed. And people connect with that. They connect with the handmade quality of it rather than it just be rapidly shot off of a printer or a copy machine. I grew to love it, and I wanted to share that love of printmaking with the kids because I think it's a really special art form. Mm-hmm. And I think, like most artists, if you love something, you want to share it with others.
So this morning, each of you gets one. This afternoon, you'll do another. Quinn, do you remember a super important rule about respect for the American flag?
Don't let it touch the ground.
You got it. Yes, Niall Kardatsky used to do it. The whole time, probably during his whole tenure.
Did you do Indiana this morning? Perfect.
I did this one last year.
You guys are so cooperative.
With three kids, get to have a little conversation with them. I don't get that chance real often, so it's nice, a nice interaction with kids for me. Plus, it's an opportunity to give them a little civics lesson, talk a little bit about the flags and the symbolism and the flag code and how we treat the American flag, and you know, that we take it down when it rains, and how we fly it. So it's an opportunity, a learning opportunity for them too.
Keep holding that just a minute longer, Lily. Daniel, you hold
every lower school part. Kid gets a chance to do it.
Give me this part. You hold that part and be unfolding it, and
so it won't touch the ground while I
clip it on. Now just keep hanging on to that end, Quinn, till it gets a little higher.
I tell you, when I talk to him about the flag, the American flag, and tell him, you know, it is never supposed to touch the ground, and you hold that in. Fourth graders remember how to do it. They pretty much have the drill down. It's the reason, that's the reason I start with fourth grade, because I'm doing first grade then in the spring.
Usually in the afternoon there's a breeze, so
they're a little more responsible in the spring than they are in the fall. A second grader last year who said to me, when I said, so what flags do you want to do? And the second grader said, I don't want to do the American flag, that's way too much pressure.
I'm going to pick up three or a few minutes after so we can take them down.
So they take it seriously, they like doing it. I like doing it. It's just a good thing.
Good job, guys. Have a good day today.
Good. Yes, sir. Nice pass! Thank you.